You mean more than this world unto me. I won't fret you for silver or gold. I won't fret you for riches untold. You are my everything. You are the love of my life. You are the hope that I cleave to. You mean more than this world unto me. I won't trade you for silver or gold. I won't fret you for riches untold, Lord. You are my everything. Daddy of a truth, you are everything. You are everything to us. With you, we don't need to add any other thing. You are everything, all that we need. You are all that we are. You are all that we ever want. We thank you for the privilege of knowing you. We thank you for the privilege of sonship. We thank you for the knowledge of you you reveal to us. We are grateful for being our Father, you being our Father. We are grateful for the relationship. We are grateful for you giving your life for us. We are grateful that in you we have everything. Thank you. Thank you. This evening again, we've gathered that you teach us. We gather that you speak to us. We gather that you reprove us. We gather that you bring us to that level you want us to be. Daddy, we ask that you speak to us, oh God. And beyond your speaking, oh God, we ask for the grace, Father, that this word will profit us, oh God, that on the last day we will not be cast away. Thank you for answering us beyond our request, for we've prayed in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Good evening, everyone. We are really happy that you are joining us again this evening. We are grateful as a church that you are with us to study at the feet of Jesus. Thank you for joining, and may the Lord bless you real good. Okay. So this evening we are going to be looking at your exchange rate for Jesus. What is your exchange rate for Jesus? Okay, there is that saying that every man has a price. Every man has a price. What's your exchange rate? What is that thing that you can exchange Jesus for? What is that thing that if you see, you can say, Jesus, I drop you here. Okay, there is a saying in my place that when a farmer sees something that is more than farming, he sells his barn. Okay, so the barn is actually where the farmer brings in all his farm produce. So when this farmer gets something, when he sees something that exceeds farming for him, what does he do? He sells that barn. Okay, so that's the question. What is that exchange rate? What is that thing that if you can see? What is that thing that if someone can trade or someone can present to you, you say, Jesus, just go your way. Okay, so we will be taking our text this evening from the book of Matthew chapter 26. We are going to read verses 14 to 16. He said, then one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went unto the chief priest. He said unto them, what will you give me? And I will deliver him unto you. And they covenanted with him for 30 pieces of silver. And from that time, he sought opportunity to betray him. Okay. So remember, we are considering what is your exchange rate for Jesus. what is your exchange rate for Jesus? So we are in a world that people can easily give up, you know, anything for Christ. And as I said before, the question is that what is your price? And when we say that, we mean that every man, there is something that if any man or if some men are persuaded, if some men are presented with, okay, if they are persuaded with that thing, they are ready to do something that is dishonest. They are ready to do something that is immoral. So that thing is their price. That is their price. So we go ahead and look at the people that actually exchange Jesus for things or for person. And it hasn't happened before, so that you know that you are not the first person to do that. Okay? And from our Bible text, we saw Judas Iscariot, one of the 12 that Jesus himself selected. One of the 12 that Jesus used to start his ministry. He exchanged Jesus for 30 shekels of silver. He exchanged Jesus. Also, we can see Peter. We can see Peter. That we see, we are going to be reading from the book of Mark. You know, when our Lord Jesus was telling Peter he was going to die, Peter said, no, that's not going to be possible. Okay, let's see Mark 14. We are going to read verse 29 to 31. He said, but Peter said unto him, although all should be offended, yet will I not. And Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto thee, that this day, even in this night, before the cock crows twice, thou shalt deny me thrice. You know, Jesus was having a conversation with Peter. He was talking about his death. Peter said, no. Jesus, forget about this thing. You are not going to die. And Jesus rebuked him. Okay? And in that verse 26, he said, but Peter said unto him, although everybody will be offended in you, even if everybody leave you, Jesus, you see me, Peter, I go nowhere. I will stand by you. I will be the last man standing by you. But what happened? At the time that Peter was confronted with reality, he denied the master. He exchanged Jesus for the fear of a little girl. He exchanged Jesus for the fear of his freedom. He didn't want them to arrest him. Because of his freedom, he denied Jesus. Are there still other people? I know you know some examples. Again, we see Gehazi, that's in 2 Kings 5, 21 to 20 to 21. Gehazi should have been a greater prophet than Elisha, the man with the double portion of the anointing. But what happened? Because of greed, he exchanged that. He exchanged Jesus on the platter of what he will get. He exchanged Jesus on the platter of satisfaction that's not going to last him for a lifetime. Then again, we ask ourselves, are there people that did not exchange Jesus for anything? Are there people that stood their ground? Has it happened before that people went through some things and they say, Jesus, is either you or I die? So that you know that if you are making that decision or you are at that level, you are not alone. People have done it before and people are still doing it. So in that light, we can see Joseph, of course we know, being a slave was already a very bad situation. A favorite child, you know, the trauma that would have brought to him, a beloved child that was being pampered. He was sold into slavery. That would have been a total bad experience for him. As if that wasn't enough, just by not accepting the pleasure from the august wife, what happened? He was thrown into prison. He was thrown into prison. Already he knew the repercussion. He knew what and what are possible if he refused to sleep with the woman. But he stood his ground. He said, I'm already a slave. If I'm going to die, let me die. We come back to ask, what were he looking at? What made him to take that decision? We come back to that. We see Daniel, we see Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, just to mention but a few. People that stood their ground in the front of furnace of fire. They know they are dead. It was life and death. But they say it's better we die than to exchange Jesus for what does not count in eternity. They say it's better we die. It's better I die. It's better I'm not promoted. It's better I die of hunger than for me to exchange Jesus for what will not count when I get to the other side of life. But the question is, there is a helplessness in man. There is helplessness in man. You know, Apostle Paul cried out, that was in Romans 7, verse 15, that the things that he wants to do, he loved to do it. I don't want to exchange Jesus for anything. I want to stand by Jesus all the days of my life. But he said, I find myself not doing them. But those ones I don't want to do, they are the ones I constantly see myself doing. And the question is, how do we come out from this? Look at Peter from the place we read. Peter told Jesus, and he was not lying. He was serious. He was sincere. He said, Jesus, if everybody will leave you, I'll be there with you. He was not trying to sugarcoat it. No, he meant it from his heart. But what happened when he was faced with reality? He could not stand. So that takes us to the place of your helplessness. He said, by power shall no man prevail. There is no man that can stand if God does not hold you. Okay, we talk about people that stood. Joseph stood. Why did he stand? He stood because he was looking at the promise of God. He was looking at what God told him. He was remembering the faithfulness of God. God, you told me this. He said, everyone will come to bow before me. He was holding on to that. And that was why in the face of everything, he said, I've not gotten there. And because it's God that promised me, I know he will not allow me to die. Even if he allow me to die, no problem. But I must hold on because I know that he that promised is faithful. He was looking at it. He said, God, you told me this. Even if though I'm in the prison, I know, God, you told me this. You still have the capacity to bring me out. We look at Daniel. What are the things that made Daniel to be able to scale through? Okay, we see Daniel was a man of prayer. It was not that day he started praying. He has been praying before that day. He has been praying, fasting Jerusalem. So it's not just a new thing that because he had that verdict, he started praying. He was a man that had a relationship with God. He had a relationship with God. So that was why he was able to stand. So I don't know the level that you are. I don't know where you are. Maybe you have made many promises to God. At one point or the other, you see yourself falling back again. You see yourself exchanging Jesus for bread and butter. You see yourself exchanging Jesus for what does not. And you are not happy about it. It's not as if you love to do that. But then, God has a word for all of us. Not just you, but every one of us, including me. And God is saying, I will help you. And God is saying, I will help you. All I just need is for you to trust in me. All I need is for you to trust in me. Looking at Peter, going back to Peter's experience. After denying Jesus, what did he do? He went back and he wept. He wept. He wept. He said, why should I have done this? Peter, I'm not the one that's supposed to do it. But some of us, we don't do that. We glory in our sin. We are comfortable in exchanging Jesus for whatever. But Peter went and he cried. What of David? When he was confronted by Prophet Nathan, he wept as well. He wept as well. And God is telling us we are helpless without him. So those promises you made, I will not do this. My sister, my brother, I'm reminding you, cannot do it by yourself. And that's why you need to link up to Christ again. It's as many that believe in him, as many that receive him and believe, it is them that he gives the power. There is a power that must be released to you before you can hold on. Before you will refuse to exchange Jesus for anything. Because there are a lot of things that the devil is presenting, very juicy. Come and take this. And they are really attractive. And they are things that we need. But you need to link up to the one that is stronger so that you will not be able to fall to that. At this time, I don't know the category you are. Maybe you are among those that are still holding on to Jesus. You've not exchanged Jesus. You are saying, I cannot. God, you will help me. Then I encourage you to continue. But remember, it's only he that stands to the end that will be saved. So you still need to hold on. You still need to be dependent on him. And there's another principle that will help you to hold on we want to look at. Look at what Jesus told Peter. in that place that we read, he said, the enemy seek to shiv you like chaff. He said, I have prayed for you. And when you are delivered, do the same thing to your brethren. Which means for you not to exchange Jesus, you must be a man that has a connect with God. You must be a man that knows how to dig out things with God in prayer. You must be a man that has a place for fellowship with the Holy Spirit. Without that, it doesn't matter how many times you make that promise, you cannot stand. You cannot stand. You will fall back again. As long as Peter on the water fixed his gaze on Christ, he did not sink. Until he started looking at the water. Look and see me, Peter, walking on the sea. See, I can get drowned. He started to drown. But that same water, when his gaze was still on Christ, he did not drown. I don't know what has taken your gaze away from Christ. At this time, can you humbly ask the Lord for mercy? I'm even talking about those that have had that relationship before and they lost it. Can you cry like Peter to him and say, Lord, I am sorry. Have mercy on me. I come back home like that prodigal son. Please, I thought I have grown. I thought I can gain my independence. I forgot. It's unto you forever, abiding in you forever. I come back, Lord. I ask that you show me mercy. I ask that you strengthen me. I put my hands, my small, tiny hands in your mighty hand. I ask that you uphold me to the end. Because why? He is able to keep that which is committed to his hand until his return. Can you go ahead and ask him, Father, please, I come back. I come back. I know your mercy. That's why you made mercy available, because of the fragility of man. Because you know we are feeble. We can't help ourselves. And Father, I come looking, coming through the blood, not on merit. I ask that you have mercy on me. Maybe you are here. You don't even know what we are talking about. You never even, anything goes in your life. Anything goes. You don't even know what it means to have a connect with Jesus, not to talk about exchanging him. Today, God is giving you another opportunity. Because at the end of the day, a day is coming. You know why it's not wise to exchange Jesus for anything? Because he is the maker. The Bible says everything was created by him. Everything was created by him and everything is for him. So how will you exchange something that belongs to somebody for him? I think that is stupidity, if I should say. So can you go ahead and give your life? Can you go ahead and ask him? I didn't even know. Do you know why? Because at the end of the day, day is coming where all those things will not matter. When you stand before him to give account of everything. And do you know what? He is the judge. He is the one you are going to appear before. Can you say, I'm sorry? I'm sorry, Lord. I see I'm a sinner and I cannot help myself. I now understand that you died for me. You were buried and resurrected that I may be saved. I ask that you forgive me, that you cleanse me, that you come into my heart. And from today, give me that power to live the life of righteousness so that I will never exchange you for anything. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for answering my prayer in Jesus' name. So if you have said this prayer, you can don't reach out to the number you will see on the screen, you know, for us to guide you on how to go about this, your new life, so that nothing can shake you again. You don't need to exchange anything for Christ. So let's just go ahead and pray. Let's ask the Lord for the grace not to exchange him for anything. Just open your mouth and ask the Lord. Maybe there are things that are already stirring. Maybe your promotion, maybe your marriage, maybe your childbirth, people are already giving you option. Why not try this? Those things there, as in you have prayed and nothing is happening. Can you ask him, Father, please help me. Come through for me. He is actually listening to you where you are. Yes, he's looking at you and he's listening. And he's nodding his head. Do you know that there's a party that has been thrown in heaven because you just came back? Go ahead and ask him for the grace. And the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. And Father, we just thank you. Thank you, the Father, that so much loves us. You don't want any of us to perish. Thank you for always calling us back. We are grateful that this evening, again, you've called us back. That nothing worth it for us to exchange you for. We are grateful in the name of Jesus. Amen. So let's go ahead and give our offering. You can see account number display. And we are also inviting you to our church service on Sunday. Okay, you can come and fellowship with us. If you are around Suru later, you can come and fellowship with us on site. If not, you can still join us on, online. And as you do that, may God bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.
This is New Wine U Church, a community of God-loving adults with a mandate to raise leaders that will influence the world positively. We meet every Sunday in church at 8:30 a.m. and online on Wednesdays at 6:30 p.m. Thank you for tuning in today. Please remember that it's not enough to just listen to God's word. The blessings come from being a doer of the word. We hope to have you worship with us on Sunday morning. God bless you.